Welcome to the video. I'm Clarity Ross. This video will give you an opportunity to do some spiritual homework. And there's two types of people in the world: those who do their spiritual homework and those who don't. And I can tell you that it's far better to do your spiritual homework than to not do it, because those who don't do it are going to find themselves in a situation that is not pleasant at all, actually. So what I have done and continue to do is try to provide some means for the world to do their homework. And this video is one of these efforts. What this video does is it takes quotes of Ramana Maharshi and puts them on a graphic background. And what I have done is I have timed each quote to give you the opportunity to actually not only read it through with the right amount of time and a little bit of space, so you're not too pressed for time, but what I suggest very strongly is that you actually speak out loud as if you were doing the narration. Now, I consider whether I would do the narration for you, but what I think is much better is to leave it silent. And so you practice doing the narration as if you were doing this video. And since it's in Creative Commons, you can even download it. And if you want to do your own narration of the slides for your own, like, project, and if you want to put music to it, fine. And maybe you want to post it somewhere on the internet, fine. It's homework for you. And I've found that in going over the time, making sure everything was timed properly, I did the narration several, maybe three times through in one evening, and it had a tremendous effect on me. It's one of the best spiritual exercises I've ever done, because in order to read it right and properly, you have to understand the gist of what is being said. Otherwise, it won't flow properly, and so you may have to go over it again and again and again. And so I suggest don't try it just once. Try to do it over and over until you can actually deliver a very smooth, very nice narration to it. And this is called, you know, doing your spiritual homework, which you have to be brilliant at it. You have to make an uncommon effort at it. You have to do something that really advances you in a tremendous way. And I can guarantee you, if you make this effort and see if you can do a polished presentation all the way through, straight through, what do I have, 99 quotes here, you will have done an exceptional thing, which is what you need to do at this time. You do need to step up and do the exceptional. So this has been an exceptional effort. And thanks to our friend of truth, who actually gathered these quotes together on a blog, and I came across them through great happenstance. What happened was, on the December 20th, I think it was the 20th or the 21st of 2013, somehow I came across Ramana Maharshi's birthday, and I realized it was his birthday. And then I looked at Google, and I realized there was no doodle, Google Doodle, for Ramana Maharshi. And I said, why is that? That Google has all these doodles of some famous person that lived in the past that, you know, that we've kind of forgotten, right? And they highlight them as some amazing, very helpful humanitarian person. But they forgot about Ramana Maharshi's birthday, his 134th birthday. So I put up on my website, "Happy birthday, Ramana. Happy birthday." It didn't really go anywhere, but I thought it should be recognized, because really, there have been very few who ever set foot on this planet that were as helpful to this world as Ramana Maharshi. Very few indeed. He has very, very, very few peers, okay? Enormously helpful. And when you read these quotes and narrate these quotes, you cannot help but get this feeling that, you know, this is greatness. This is greatness here. This is great helpfulness here that we are dealing with. And so it's a great blessing to be able to do this. So give it your best effort, and it's not going to be easy. It's not going to be easy at all. So, but that's the whole point of it, is to take the challenge. Take the Ramana Maharshi quotation challenge and see if you can narrate a great job Maybe I should make a contest out of it, but I probably won't. Who can do the best narration and post it on, I'll post them on YouTube and et cetera, et cetera. But just try and do your best, and it should wear you out. You know, you should just think, wow, this is just a supreme challenge to see if I can really nail this. Really nail it. And of course, you could also listen to it at your leisure with, like, you can put on your favorite music, spiritual music in the background. You can listen to it silently. You can pause the video as you go along to give yourself more time to absorb it. Whatever you would like to do. But make sure that you do your homework right now, lest you end up like those who fail to do their homework. And that is going to be very pitiful, for sure. So don't end up there. Keep on pressing forward. Keep on making maximum effort. And without further ado, let us turn it over to you now and this incredible opportunity to experience some of the very best quotes of Ramana Maharshi. If one who desires the true nature of one's own self, being consciousness bliss, abandons everything else as being false, then Padam, the formless self, is directly experienced. In the straight path of Svarupa Vichara, inquiry into one's own nature, no fear or confusion arises because of the non-dual nature of the self. The self alone exists, and the self alone is real. Verily, the self alone is the world, the I, and God. All that exists is but the manifestation of the Supreme Being. Self-inquiry alone can reveal the truth that neither the ego nor the mind really exists and enable one to realize the pure, undifferentiated being of the self or the absolute. Having realized the self, nothing remains to be known because it is perfect bliss. It is the all. The power that created you has created the world as well. If it can take care of you, it can similarly take care of the world also. If God has created the world, it is His business to look after it, not yours. As for prayer for the sake of others, it looks so unselfish on the surface of it, but analyze the feeling and you will detect selfishness there also. You desire others' happiness so that you may be happy. Or you want the credit for having interceded on others' behalf. God does not require an intermediary. Mind your own business, and all will be well. To be the self that you really are is the only means to realize the bliss that is ever yours. The self you seek to know is verily yourself. Bliss is not added to your nature, it is merely revealed as your true and natural state. Bliss of the self is always with you, and you will find it for yourself if you seek it earnestly. What is fear? It is only a thought. If there is anything besides the self, there is reason to fear. Who sees the second anything external? First, the ego arises and sees objects as external. If the ego does not rise, the self alone exists, and there is no second, nothing external. For anything external to oneself implies the seer within. Seeking it there will arise no doubt, no fear, not only fear, all other thoughts centered around the ego will disappear along with it. self-inquiry leads directly to self-realization by removing the obstacles which make you think that the self is not already realized. Only he who has himself won salvation can lead others to salvation. Your duty is to be, and not to be this or that. I am that I am sums up the whole truth. The method is summed up in the words, be still. What does stillness mean? It means destroy yourself, because any form or shape is the cause for trouble. Give up the notion that I am so and so. All that is required to realize the self is to be still. What can be easier than that? It will come out all right in the end. There is a steady impulse of your determination that sets you on your feet again. After every downfall and breakdown, gradually the obstacles are all overcome and your current becomes stronger. Everything comes right in the end. Steady determination is what is required. Aim high. Aim at the highest, and all lower aims are thereby achieved. It is looking below on the stormy sea of differences that makes you sink. Look up beyond these and see the one glorious real, and you are saved. You can feel yourself at one with the one that exists. The whole body becomes a mere power, a force current. Your life becomes a needle drawn to a huge mass of a magnet, and as you go deeper and deeper, you become a mere center, and then not even that. For you become a mere consciousness. There are no thoughts or cares any longer. They were shattered at the threshold in an inundation. You, a mere straw, are swallowed alive, but it is very delightful, for you become the very thing that swallows you. This is the union of Jiva with Brahman, the loss of the ego in the real self, the destruction of falsehood, the attainment of truth. By whatever path you go, you will have to lose yourself in the One. Surrender is complete only when you reach the stage, Thou art all, and Thy will be done. Only when the self is gained is permanent, perfect, blissful peace attained. In this self-sovereignty, non-dual, heaven-like, all-pervasive, no desire and no fear can exist. He who turns inward with an untroubled mind to search where the consciousness I arises, realizes the self and rests in that, like a river when it joins the ocean. Inquire until there is no one left to inquire. Illusion is outside and unknown, but the seeker is considered to be known and is inside. Find out what is immediate, intimate, instead of trying to find out what is distant and unknown. Param, the formless self, torments those whose hearts harbor attachments, but brings to light to those whose hearts possess the generosity of not clinging to anything. If there be a goal to be reached, it cannot be permanent. The goal must already be there. We seek to reach the goal with the ego, but the goal exists before the ego. What is in the goal is even prior to our birth, i.e. the birth of the ego. Because we exist, the ego appears to exist too. If we look on the self as the ego, then we become the ego. If as the mind, we become the mind. If as the body, we become the body. It is the thought which builds up sheaths in so many ways. The pure mind is itself Brahman. Therefore it follows that Brahman is not other than the mind of the sage. In dreamless sleep there is no world, no ego, and no unhappiness, but the self remains. In the waking state there are all of these, yet there is the self. One has only to remove the transitory happenings in order to realize the ever-present beatitude of the self. Know thyself, all else will be known to thee of its own accord. Discriminate between the undying, unchanging, all-pervading, infinite Atma and the ever-changing, phenomenal, imperishable universe and body. Inquire, who am I? Make the mind calm. Free yourself from all thoughts other than the simple thought of the self or Atma. Dive deep into the chambers of your heart. Find out the real infinite I. Rest there peacefully forever and become identical with the Supreme Self. When one has completely surrendered oneself at the feet of Shiva, thereby becoming of the nature of the self, the resulting abundant peace in which there is not even the least room within the heart for one to make any complaint about one's defects and deficiencies, alone is the nature of supreme devotion. One's thus becoming a slave to the Lord, and one's remaining quiet and silent, devoid even of the egotistical thought, I am his slave, is self-abidance, and this is the supreme knowledge. If you make your outlook that of wisdom, you will find the world to be God. The sage does not know the self because he is the self. The bliss of self is always yours, and you will find it if you seek it earnestly. The cause of your misery is not in your outer life. It is in you, as your ego. You impose limitations on yourself and then make a vain struggle to transcend them. All unhappiness is due to the ego. With it comes all your trouble. What does it avail you to attribute the cause of misery to the happenings of life when the cause is really within you? What happiness can you get from things extraneous to yourself? When you get it, how long will it last? If you would deny the ego and scorch it by ignoring it, you would be free. If you accept it, it will impose limitations on you and throw you into vain struggle to transcend them. The death of the ego in the unlimited silence, the non-dual truth, and the shining forth of self is the attainment of oneness. In that state of jhana, pure bliss will gloriously blaze forth as one's own true nature. There are no others. Reality is simply the loss of ego. Destroy the ego by seeking its identity. Because the ego is no entity, it will automatically vanish and reality will shine forth by itself. The reflected light of the mind is necessary to perceive the world composed of objects. But to see the heart, it is enough for the mind to be turned towards it. Then the mind is lost in it, and the heart shines forth. Complete surrender does require that you have no desire of your own. You must be satisfied with whatever God gives you, and that means having no desires of your own. Desire is illusion. Desirelessness is God. Instead of going on, driven by the restless thoughts, performing actions such as, I should do this, or I should give up that, as if they were worthy to be done, acting according to how the grace of God, the Lord of our souls, leads us, is the right form of truly worshiping Him. All that one gives to others, one gives to oneself. If this truth is understood, who will not give to others? When one's self arises, all arises. When one's self becomes quiescent, all becomes quiescent. To the extent we behave with humility, to that extent there will result good. If the mind is rendered quiescent, one may live anywhere. Whatever is destined not to happen will not happen, try as you may. Whatever is destined to happen will happen, do what you may to prevent it. This is certain. The best course, therefore, is to remain silent. The mind turned outwards results in thoughts and objects. Turned inwards, it becomes itself, the self. There can be no desire if there is no object. The state of no desire is moksha. There is no duality in sleep and also no desire. Whereas there is duality in the waking state and desire also is there. Because of duality, a desire arises for the acquisition of the object. That is the outgoing mind, which is the basis of duality and of desire. If one knows that bliss is none other than the self, the mind becomes inward turned. If the self is gained, all the desires are fulfilled. All the texts say that in order to gain release, one should render the mind quiescent. Therefore, their conclusive teaching is that the mind should be rendered quiescent. Once this has been understood, there is no need for endless reading. In order to quiet the mind, one has only to inquire within oneself what oneself is. How could this search be done in books? One should know oneself with one's own eye of wisdom. The self is within the five sheaths, but books are outside them. Since the self has to be inquired into by discarding the five sheaths, it is futile to search for it in books. There will come a time when one will have to forget all that one has learned. Distracted as we are by various thoughts, if we would continually contemplate the self, which is itself God, this single thought would in due course replace all distraction and would itself ultimately vanish. The pure consciousness that alone finally remains is God. This is liberation. Under whatever name or form we worship it, it leads us on to knowledge of the nameless, formless, absolute. Yet to see one's true self in the absolute, to subside into it and be one with it, this is the true knowledge of the truth. Be aware that the I am the body ego is truly the one unique cause of all the sorrows of samsara.
Therefore, make genuine, firm, and steady efforts to destroy that ego and desist from making any other kind of effort. Mind is consciousness, which has put on limitations. You are originally unlimited and perfect. Later, you take on limitations and become the mind. In silence, one is in intimate contact with the surroundings. In the state of silence, one merely abides as I. Apart from this, there is neither thinking nor knowing. Silence will manifest itself when the clarity of self-knowledge, which overflows with the exalted direct experience, causes the trinities of seer seeing seen and knower knowing known to depart. If the trinities that have arisen from silence subside in silence, then bliss will arise. The self is only one. Do you feel hurt if you blame yourself or scorn yourself for your errors? If you hold the self, there is no second person to scorn you. The self is the real book. To whatever extent that mind consciousness dives within, to that same extent will the bliss of the self spring forth and reveal itself. Mind it is that binds man, and the same mind it is that liberates him. Mind is constituted of sankalpa and vikalpa, desire and disposition. Desire shapes and governs disposition. Desire is of two kinds, the noble and the base. The base desires are lust and greed. Noble desire is directed towards enlightenment and emancipation. Base desire contaminates and clouds the understanding. Sadhana is easy for the aspirant who is endowed with noble desires. Calmness is the criterion of spiritual progress. Plunge the purified mind into the heart, then the work is over. This is the essence of all spiritual discipline. You know that you know nothing. Find out that knowledge. That is liberation. To those who have not realized the self, as well as to those who have, the word I refers to the body, but with this difference, that for those who have not realized, the I is confined to the body, whereas for those who have realized the self within the body, the I shines as the limitless self. The state we call realization is simply being oneself, not knowing anything or becoming anything. If one has realized, he is that which alone is and which alone has always been. He cannot describe that state. He can only be that. Liberation is not anywhere outside you. It is only within. If you are abiding within the self, there are no other people. You and I are the same. When I pray for you, I pray for myself. And when I pray for myself, I pray for you. Real prayer is to abide within the self. This is the meaning of Tat Tuam Asi, thou art that. That thou art. There can be no separation in the self. There is no need for prayer for yourself or any person other than to abide within the self. a higher power is leading you. Be led by the same. The higher power knows what to do and how to do it. Trust it. The pure state of being attached to grace, self, which is devoid of any attachment, alone, is one's own state of silence, which is devoid of any other thing. Know that one's ever abiding as that silence, having experienced it as it is, alone is true mental worship. Know that the performance of the unceasing true and natural worship in which the mind is submissively established as the one self, having installed the Lord on the heart throne, is silence, the best of all forms of worship. Silence, which is devoid of the assertive ego, alone is liberation. The evil forgetfulness of self, which causes one to slip down from that silence, alone is non-devotion. Know that abiding as that silence, with the mind subsided as non-different from self, is the truth of devotion to God. They pray to God and finish with, "Thy will be done." If His will be done, why do they pray at all? It is true that the divine will prevails at all times and under all circumstances. The individuals cannot act of their own accord, recognize the force of the divine will, and keep quiet. Real attainment is to be fully conscious, to be aware of surroundings and the people around, to move among them all, but not to merge consciousness in the environment. One should remain in inner independent awareness. If you renounce and give up everything, what remains is only moksha. We dig a well and create a huge pit. The space in the pit or well has not been created by us. We have just removed the earth which was filling the space there. The space was there then and is also there now. Similarly, we have simply to throw out all the age-long innate tendencies which are inside us. When all of them have been given up, the self will shine alone. The realized being does not see the world as different from himself. When you are the self, the world appears as reality. A humble attitude of mind will give you redemption, transporting you to the world of the immortals. Without humility, you will drown in the pitch of hell. When one has completely surrendered oneself at the feet of Shiva, thereby becoming of the nature of the self, the resulting abundant peace, in which there is not even the least room within the heart for one to make any complaint about one's defects and deficiencies, alone is the nature of supreme devotion. One's thus becoming a slave to the Lord, and one's remaining quiet and silent, devoid even of the egotistical thought, "I am his slave," is self-abidance, and this is the supreme knowledge. The natural name of every person is mukti, liberation. When the pure, gracious Supreme reveals the nature of self, he who is in the dark room of ignorance will merge into the silence of self-abidance, drowning in God knowledge or existence consciousness, which is the beauty of the reality. First, clear your own eyes. If you do this, you will see the eyes of all others as your own. Then, if you see the eyes of all others as your own, how can you exist without helping them? Clinging to that pure state, which remains without any attachments, is clinging to divine grace. This alone is one's own state of silence, wherein nothing else exists. If one gains the peace of the self, it will spread without any effort on the part of the individual. When one is not peaceful oneself, how can one spread peace in the world? Unless one is happy, one cannot bestow happiness on others. Happiness is born of peace and can reign only when there is no disturbance. Disturbance is due to thoughts which arise in the mind. When the mind is absent, there will be perfect peace. What is the self. It is all-pervading. We fill the mind with all sorts of impressions and then say there is no room for the self in it. If all the false ideas and impressions are swept away and thrown out, what remains is a feeling of fullness, which is the self. Then there will be no such things as a separate I. That which is worthy to have as one's target is self, the knowledge which is pure bliss. The perfect life is for one to exist directly as that self, abiding in the heart through the unforgettable knowledge, I am. Ask yourself the question, who am I? This investigation will lead in the end to the discovery of something within you which is behind the mind. Solve that great problem, and you will solve all other problems thereby. The self, one's real nature, alone exists and is real. The world, the soul, and God are all superimpositions on it, like the illusory appearance of silver and the mother of pearl. These three appear and disappear simultaneously. Self itself is the world. Self itself is the I. Self itself is God. All is Shiva, the self. The enemy hates the ego, which the seeker wants to kill. Thus, like the anvil to the goldsmith, he is actually a friend. He who gives himself up to the self, that is God, is the most excellent devotee. Giving oneself up to God means constantly remembering the self. All metaphysical discussion is profitless unless it causes us to seek within the self for the true reality. All controversies about creation, the nature of the universe, evolution, the purpose of God, etc. are useless. They are not conducive to our true happiness. People try to find out about these things which are outside of them before they try to find out who am I. Only by the latter means can happiness be gained. Happiness is your nature. It is not wrong to desire it. What is wrong is seeking it outside when it is inside. The self cannot be found in books. You have to find it for yourself, in yourself. Reality must always be real. It is not with forms and names. That which underlies these is the reality. It underlies limitations, being itself limitless. It is not bound. It underlies unrealities, itself being real. Reality is all that which is. The realized being sees only the self. If objects had an independent existence, then it would be possible for you to go away from them. But they do not exist apart from you. They owe their existence to you, to your thoughts. So where can you go to escape them? Where can you go fleeing the world and objects? Meditation requires an object to meditate on, whereas in self-inquiry, there is only the subject and no object. That is the difference between them. The self is bliss. To realize bliss, one realizes the self. The pure state of attention to the self alone is one's own state of silence, which is devoid of any other thing. If you adhere to that path of silence, the means to liberation, there will be no suffering of any kind. The supreme reality that is liberation is experienced only by perfect silence. Indulging in thoughts drives it away. If the jiva, who is ever deluded and is always suffering from a feeling of deficiency, wants to get rid of all his miseries and to be happy, he need only know the Supreme One, his Lord, to be his own self. The only happiness there is of the self. That is the truth. There is no happiness in worldly objects. Because of our ignorance, we imagine we derive happiness from them. I am alone really exists. So it is the true form of God and Guru. To treat and cherish this filthy body as I is therefore the worst kind of idol worship. If we give up this idol worship by knowing the truth of ourself, then we can worship anything as God, because we will know that nothing is other than Him, our real self. For him who is immersed in the bliss of the self, arising from the extinction of the ego, what remains to be accomplished? He is not aware of anything as other than the self. Who can apprehend this, his state? That which is peace. All that we need do is to keep quiet. Peace is our real nature. We spoil it. What is required is that we cease to spoil it. For instance, there is space in a hall room. We are not going to create space anew. We fill up the place with various articles. If we want space, all that we need do is to remove all those articles and we get space. Similarly, if we remove all the rubbish from the mind, the peace will become manifest. That which is obstructing the peace must be removed. Peace is the only reality. We are so engrossed with the objects or appearances revealed by the light that we pay no attention to the light. The thing to do is to concentrate on the seer and not on the seen. Not on the objects, but on the light which reveals them. During worldly activity, if your attention is fixed on the fundamental reality, there is no difficulty. But ordinary people forget the reality and take the name alone to be real. The different eyes are not real. There is only one eye. The separate eye is like a watchman in a fort. He is like the protector of the body. The real owner in everybody is only the one real eye. So, when the separate I surrenders to the real I, then because the idea of a separate self who owns the body disappears, I and mine are eliminated. The true state comes into existence when, after sorting out what belongs to whom, the ego I surrenders itself to the real owner. Know that the one real I appears to be many eyes because of the wrong outlook that each body is an I. But through the outlook of self, the one eternal existence consciousness, know them all to be one. So long as you are seeking something other than yourself as the agent for gaining bliss, there is no bliss for you. The vision of the self will only be encountered by those who are free of the delusion of desire, and not by more whose corrupted minds are full of desires for sense object. You will know in due course that your glory lies where you cease to exist. In order to gain that state, you should surrender yourself. Self is only being, not being this or that. It is simple being, be, and there is the end of ignorance. Param, the formless self, pure consciousness, demands that everything that has been learned as knowledge has to be completely forgotten as ignorance. It is enough that one surrenders oneself. Surrender is to give oneself up to the original cause of one's being. Do not delude yourself by imagining such a source to be some god outside you. Your source is within yourself. Give yourself up to it. That means that you should seek the source and merge in it. Remain all the time steadfast in the heart. God will determine the future for you to accomplish the work. What is to be done will be done at the proper time. Don't worry. Abide in the heart. If we see the self, the objects which are seen will not appear as separate from us. Having seen all the letters on a paper, we fail to see that paper which is the base. Likewise, suffering only arises because we see what is superimposed on the base without seeing the base itself. What is superimposed should not be seen without also seeing the substratum. Because you give precedence to worldly things, God appears to have receded to the background. If you give up all else and seek Him alone, He alone will remain as the I, the Self. All things exist depending on Param, the formless Self. But the Param, the formless Self, has no desire whatsoever for any of those things. Desirelessness is refraining from turning the mind towards any object. Wisdom means the appearance of no object. In other words, not seeking what is other than the self is detachment or desirelessness. Not leaving the self is wisdom.